welcome BPC to worship and anyone else who may join us on the YouTube. Of course, we've opened up the buildings themselves, and this whole service will be available there live on Sundays, and I'll preach live, but it's the same message. Okay, helping us with our worship today, Dee and Julian and Elsa B and Trevor, Elmin, Elzon and Sasha. Glory be to God for you, lovely people, and thank you so much. David says, wait upon the Lord. David says, be still and know God. David says, the Lord is my strength and my song. David says, ascribe to the Lord greatness and power. David says, worship the Lord in the beauty of his holiness. All those things can be ours if we just decide, let's give ourselves to God in worship. So worship well. As we sing two songs, Hallelujah and 10,000 Reasons, Bless the Lord, O my soul. Let's worship now, and afterwards Trevor will pray for us.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for my life. I want to thank you for the lives of my family and my friends. So many families lost loved ones through this COVID pandemic. Thank you, Lord, for taking care of myself while I was doing essential work during this lockdown. Thank you, Lord, for taking care of my family while I was away from home. Thank you, Lord, for food on our tables and a roof over our heads. So many people lost everything the last couple of months. Thank you for second chances, Lord. Thank you for taking care of Wilma in ICU, and we trust she will fully recover. Thank you for doing for me what I could not do for myself. Thank you for sobriety. Thank you for serenity. And thank you for sanity. I needed my sanity during the last couple of months. By your grace, I can be a better husband, a better father, a better grandfather, and a better friend. Lord, I want to give thanks for allowing us, your church, to start functioning normally in these trying times again. Thank you for your trusted servant, Rod, who is not only our minister, but also a father figure in our congregation. Heavenly Father, if I have sinned in any form, in thought, word or deed, I ask you to forgive me. Thank you for the knowledge that Jesus Christ came to forgive our sins. We rejoice our sins are forgiven. Amen.
I'm going to sing two other songs now, another medley. I love you, Lord, and I lift my hands to the coming King. I'll serve no foreign God. So sing well, and then Julian and Dee will read the scriptures to us from Matthew and from John, and then I will try and make sense of it for us all. Let's sing well again. I love you, Lord. Thank you.
reading from Matthew 22, from verses 1 to 14. The parable of the wedding banquet. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened calf have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, the other to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find.' So the servants went into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. He asked, 'How did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend?' The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, 'Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there would be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen.'"
I am reading from John 15, verse 15 to verse 17. "I do not call you servants any longer, because a servant does not know what his master is doing. Instead, I call you friends, because I have told you everything I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me. I chose you and appointed you to go and bear much fruit, the kind of fruit that endures. And so the Father will give you whatever you ask of him in my name. This then is what I command you: love one another." Praise be to God.
So, BBC, last week in our study on Matthew, remember we slowly going through Matthew's Gospel, we learned that the Father will give the kingdom to those who produce fruit. He wants people in his kingdom who produce the fruit of the kingdom, who live according to the kingdom of God. The key word in today's passage from Matthew is chosen. Chosen and appointed to bear good fruit. Chosen. The sermon's a bit longer than it was last week, and just ask you to listen more carefully. It's not much longer, but it is. So two things out of my past around the word chosen. One from play and the other from school. Let's do the play one first. So when I was a teenager, I lived in the place that was called Flatland in Durban. Lots of flats along the beachfront. And we lived just two blocks from the North Beach in Durban. And in front of our building was a long open park area. And we would gather there every afternoon, 4 o'clock, half past four, just a bunch of boys. And we would play soccer until dark, or until one of our mommies came to call us home for supper. And it went like this. Somehow we elected two captains, and they chose their teams, one by one. You'll remember it yourselves, I guess, from school days. We'd all line up, and then one by one, they would choose this one and choose that one. If there were an equal number, boy, you felt safe. You were going to get a game, and you'd be chosen. If there was an odd number, you kind of held your heart in your mouth, hoping to be chosen quickly, and that you wouldn't end up being the odd man out and sit on the side for the match. I can't ever remember being odd man out, but I can remember the anxiety of being left until almost last and thinking I may be unchosen today. Chosen, something from school now. I changed schools and provinces halfway through Standard 4. That's grade 6. Oh, I'm confused now, but Standard 4, Grade 6, I think. Of course, going to a new school, you learned all sorts of new things. that were kind of different. And boys wore sandals, I discovered, in KwaZulu-Natal. That seemed really strange to me. Anyway, it came time to appoint prefects, and I never gave a thought at all to becoming a prefect, having been in the school for just two short terms. But I was chosen. Absolute surprise, I was chosen as a prefect, and I remember feeling good. Not proud at all, but just really good. Well, got to high school, and as the years rolled on, I wanted to be a prefect at high school. If you ask me why, I probably couldn't think of any real reason, except, well, I was one at primary school. But in reality, I knew I could not become a prefect. I, first of all, wasn't in the in crowd. I wasn't popular. I wasn't really disliked by anybody in particular, except one miserable chap. And he wasn't a prefect anyway, he was just a sad soul. But I wasn't in the in group. I didn't play first team rugby, didn't play first team cricket. My academics were poor, and I wasn't a teacher's pet. So I put out of my mind the thought that I wanted to be a prefect, because it just wasn't going to be possible. Anyway, the day came, the end of standard 9, grade 11, when they announced the prefects for the following year in assembly, and what a shocking surprise when the headmaster called out the 12th name, the last name of the 12 prefects for next year. And he said the 12th boy chosen to be a prefect for next year is Botsis Roderick from class 9M. But I felt like I felt 5 years earlier. Just good, not proud, but just wonderfully good that I had been chosen. I was bewildered, quite honestly, but it was a marvelous feeling that I had been chosen. The teachers did the choosing, and I honestly was not close to any particular teacher that would make me be favored. So how it happened, I don't know, but I was now one of the chosen. I was never a very extraordinary or out of the ordinary prefect, very average at the job. But I want to tell you, dare I admit it, often I felt wonderful, really good at being chosen. And folks, that's exactly how I felt when I realized God loved me and I gave my life to Him at 14 years old. I knew God loved me. And I felt I am chosen by Him. When I gave my life to Christ and knew He loved me, I felt so good at being chosen. And I hope that's true for you. Jesus says so clearly, I chose you. You did not choose me. I try and tell couples that at weddings to get them to look at each other, bride and groom, and to register, this person has chosen you. You didn't choose them, they chose you. And Jesus says just that, John 15, 16, I chose you, you did not choose me. We call that salvation, friends. Let that settle deep in your head. We call that salvation, being chosen by God. So this parable of the wedding banquet's a bit strange. It doesn't quite fit into our world today. But remember me teaching you a year or so ago that every parable has just one general truth. And the one general truth of this parable is Jesus saying, many are invited, many, but few are chosen. So if you're invited, register, you've been chosen, and now behave appropriately. So if the wedding invitation says, wear good clothes, don't come up in slops and discover the anger of the hosts. That happened to the one chap in the parable. So, PPC, I really want you to feel again today the joy of being chosen, to feel good that Jesus has chosen you, and then to register, because we're chosen, we can behave appropriately. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about Jesus and a little bit about Paul and Peter and James, all around being chosen. So listen well. Firstly, Jesus. He says, I chose you, you did not choose me. But when he sends out a group of 72 people on a mission, and they come back with wonderful stories of what's happened as they've spoken about the kingdom of God and helped people, healed people, Jesus says this to them. It's Luke 10, verse 21. I chose you so that I can reveal the Father to you. Wow. The fact that we're chosen means Jesus has been able to reveal aspects of the Father's character and person to us. So when Paul says that he is the God of all comfort and the Father of all compassion, and we've understood the comfort of God and have been able to comfort others, that's because we've been chosen. Being chosen has allowed us to learn from the Father, of the Father, and he's comforted us so we behave appropriately and comfort others. Paul, he says to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26, you are chosen. Don't put yourselves down. And then he tries to get them to remember what they were before they became Christians. Not great by any worldly standards, but he says, but God has chosen you. Oh, there are a couple of places in the Bible where we hear this, but God. You may think of yourself in this way, but God has chosen you. Peter. When Peter writes in his first letter, it's chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, he's telling the early Christians that once you were not a people, once you were not loved, but now you are his people and you are loved and you are a holy nation, a people giving glory to God because you've been chosen. You've been chosen to be his. It's just an absolute marvelous thought. Jesus, Peter, Paul. I'm going to tell you something about James. Listen up, will you? So now James, the brother of our Lord Jesus, he registers that Jesus does the choosing. And then he writes a letter to the church around him, a scattered church for a century. And he's actually cross because he's discovering that some communities of Christians have begun to favor the rich against the poor. They are practicing favoritism on the basis of the wealth of the people around them. And James will have none of it. And he tells them, God has chosen the poor to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom of God. Jesus' brother said, the meek inherit the earth. James puts it slightly differently, but says, poor people have been chosen to be rich in faith. And it's true. After many years of working with the poor, you discover, man, they've got faith for their next meal in the way we don't have. They believe somehow they're going to get fed. And they pray to God for it. Thank God for it. James goes on, though, in his irritation with the early church practicing favoritism, and he says, because they've done this, listen, he says, you have insulted the poor. Wow, what a blow. James 2 verse 6, you've insulted the poor because they're chosen by God, and you are choosing to behave as if God had nothing in this, and you only get to choose what's good and right in the kingdom. So the rebuke comes, because we know in Old and New Testament, God chooses whom he wishes to be his people. He chooses them to be holy and blameless. He chooses them to bear witness to him. He chooses them to be the light to the world. He chooses them to perform deeds, good deeds, of great works for his honor and glory. So all over the scriptures comes the truth, we've been chosen. James sharpens it by saying, because you've chosen, make sure you choose everybody else as well. Peter, Paul, Jesus, accept that you are chosen because God loves you. Let me end. When I played soccer on those afternoons as a teenager, the simple fact was I had been chosen to play with the rest of the team to the best of my ability. I had been chosen to play with the rest of the team to the best of my ability. And folks, I've discovered when I do these three things, play, work, worship, play with other Christians to the best of my ability to declare Jesus, to accept others irrespective of who they are, and to do good deeds of work appropriate to the kingdom of God. When I realize I've been chosen to talk about Jesus, to incorporate others, include them, and to do good deeds, I feel good. Something happens when I do those three simple things, chosen to do them. And I've come to understand that good feeling is the Holy Spirit telling me, well done. You're right in line with what God wants. You're chosen, and you're behaving as He wants you to behave. There's no better feeling than that in all the world. So, go out, folks, this week, please. Abandon yourselves to loving others. Abandon yourselves to live like a chosen one and sent to do good works. I hope you have fun, and I hope you just feel good often. God loves me, and you are able to love others. Thanks for listening. More next week. Elsa B is now going to lead us in prayer for other people. And then we'll conclude our worship today by singing Christ Our Hope in Life and Death.
Let us pray for other people.
Lord, we pray for Rod, our priest, and his family, for religious communities, for peace in the world, for a COVID-free world, for all hospital staff, for the sick, for those who are feeling lonely, for those suffering addiction, for the oppressed, for the unemployed, for the aged, especially those in old age homes, for the corruption in our country. Lord, please guide our leaders of our country. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Yeah. He lives, Christ He lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him, there we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.